Yo, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to the Sayless podcast. Hey, before we get into things, Dogo, cue that track. Let's go. What's up, everyone? Tala for love of my lord, lay pool of Inaka, and namaste to aloha. All our viewers out there, another episode here, Sayless Podcast, is your also Sefa, your toko atu, ladies and gentlemen. Woohoo! Straight out of Massey.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, George Pisi. What's up, Mauso?
Sabuso.
Talafa, Malosos.
Man, hey, bro, thank you for jumping on, man. Honestly,
it's an honor.
For giving up your time, you know, from the Ainga and, you know, just being here with us. How's it been, bro?
It's been awesome. Back in New Zealand now,
yes,
you know, career's finished. It's a bit of a transition, but you know, just enjoying it. Hey, summer's been beautiful here.
Yeah, man.
And just having that special time with family. Yeah, hey, that's it's probably the best thing I've missed.
Yeah. Man, how's the year so far? Because you know because you're at Massey now, hey, Massey High.
Yeah. So I'm a dean up at Massey High. My old stomping ground.
Yes, sir.
So I enjoy it now. I've been there for a couple of years.
Yeah.
Been there for a couple of years. Surrounded by some good colleagues, some good brothers that are there. With Dwayne Toko and also Victor Kalolo and also Scotty Jones. Yeah. So, you know, we've all got different stories.
Yeah.
But you know, I really enjoy it there, and our passion is our Pasifika, Māori Pasifika kids, also just our youth, hey?
Yeah.
Our youth, you know, it's just about, I see my role as more teaching them life lessons, teaching them life lessons that that they can use in life and probably that the curriculum doesn't teach her.
Yeah, true that. Do you see any little glimpse of little George PCs running around at school? Like little reminders, like, man, I was that kid.
Sorry. Tell me, mate. I see a lot of them. I see a lot of them, mate. They're the ones that come up to the office and I'm like,
oh, I'm telling
you, go down this road, man. Don't go down this road.
Yeah.
I'm speaking from experience.
Yeah.
Down this road, man. This is why I'm here. Yeah.
Nah, that's awesome, bro. Well, we're gonna get straight into it. We want to dig in more about, you know, your childhood and stuff. So yeah, let's go. I think the ducks is frozen. But that's all good. He's back on. Shoot it.
George PC, we just want to dig into your childhood, mate, and how that was like growing up. Obviously, the career ahead would change your life in that sense of way. But like, what was it like growing up in the area, being a young Polynesian boy? And what was that like for you and your family?
Well, I was born in Samoa. Mom and dad, our dad moved over here, you know, just to start up. We moved here when I was three, just before my little brother Ken was born. We moved around. We started in Avondale, up at Canal Road, where everyone's been. And then we shifted out to Massey, went to school at West Harbour. I thought it was normal. We were a family that struggled, but you know, mum and dad never showed us that. You know, we're these kids that were having fishy chips every day, and then mum and dad's having noodles and that, we don't even know, you know. But that's the upbringing that we kind of got, was that mum and dad trying to give us as much as, you know, they can. Up at West Harbour Primary School, there was a lot of us islanders up there. So it was kind of the hood of Massey up there. So enjoyed it at West Harbour, and then we moved out to Hula Road closer to Massey High.
Yeah.
Moved out those ways, and then it was always rugby, man. That was our life. And that was mum and dad everywhere, every game, You know, they'll be there supporting us.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
You know the silent treatments when you have a bad game.
Yeah, yeah.
A long drive home, mate. I was like,
yo. How many of these was?
So there's four of us, these four boys. There's one younger sister. She's just finished Pisi. I happened to be her dean last year, so so it's keeping her on her toes, yeah.
Cool, cool. Awesome. And you're the...
I'm the second. Number.
Oh, awesome. And you guys all played rugby, right?
Yeah, we all play rugby. We all play rugby. Okay. Apart from my sister.
Yeah.
Mom's like, no. Schoolwork, no.
How was that growing up, bro? Like, with all your brothers playing... rugby. Did you guys all play the same position?
No. We're all backs. You know, we're all too skinny. Skinny to teach kids back then. Tusa was always a 10.
Yeah.
You know, 10, 12. And I was always a midfielder, but also fullback. But Ken was more of a winger. And then I got my younger brother, Mac. Got my younger brother Mac, who's I think he's 24 now, so he was a lot younger than us.
Yeah,
but growing up, it was just us three.
Mm. Yeah,
Tusa and Ken. Yeah, and it was hard for my parents because we played in different grades, huh?
Yeah,
different grades and different times, but they were always at least one of them. They'll drop them off early, drop mom off early, and dad will go to one game and try to catch another one. That's the support that they have for us, huh?
Oh, that's awesome. Man. You guys got into high school. What was that like being, the Pisi brothers, you know, going through that, Tusi, yourself and Ken? Was there a massive expectation put on your shoulders from a lot of maybe classmates or rugby mates that grew up alongside you?
I don't think so. I think around that time that we were coming through up at Massey, probably my brother's last year was when Massey Rugby started to really get on the scene. Times that they played, I think it was my brother's last year, they played at Kelston in the Nationals, game there. And that just started, that's when rugby really started to grow at Massey.
So
there was not much expectations. It was more between friends and all that. But in terms of like coaches and that, we weren't known back then. And it was still growing. So I never got to play with my older brother then, but I got to play with my younger brother, with Ken.
Mm.
So I was at sixth form and he was this young kid. I was at third form and he was playing with us around that time as well. So
And going through your high school days, mate, what was... who was your inspiration growing up through those years?
My dad.
Yeah.
My dad was the biggest inspiration. I think just the time he spent with us in terms of, you know, taking us to trainings, taking us to games.
Yeah.
And the hard work that he does, you know, going to work. Mm. You don't see him till like 6 at night. Mm. But then he'll be there to pick you up from training or to take you here. Doesn't matter if it's out, you know, out in Silverdale, because, you know, we're in the harbour comp.
Yeah.
No matter if it's out there, eh? He'll still take you. And back then, you know, we're playing, that's when Walter Dixon and all that. Boo McLaren.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was still this little skinny little boy. I was still playing like the 45 kilos. You know, and that's kind of, the taste of rip rugby that I kind of got at that young age.
Yeah.
That was always... was always there with mom.
Yeah, man, that's awesome. Would you say high school would be one of your favorite years of rugby?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. Why is that?
I think the relationships you build. I think also. Yeah, the schoolwork didn't really go that well. It was really, I still tell the story to the kids, like, hey, they go to school to eat your lunch and chase girls and used to be me. Right? And I think just building the relationship with friends and that, you know, and being able to, we got opportunity to go to Six Nations. Last year we got to visit England, Italy, all those places. You know, and this is a young for young brown boys from New Zealand to get a taste of the world. It's like amazing. Yeah, but then back then the English pound was at 3-1. So these boys thinking, oh, it's only like £10, $10. Yeah. And then look at their bank, it's $35 that's gone down the drain.
Yeah. Nah, that's, man. Yeah, it's different nowadays, like with first 15 rugby, because it's almost professional rugby with first 15 because it's being televised. And would you say that, is that a good thing or is that a challenging thing for first 15 players nowadays, high school players nowadays? What's your take on that?
It goes both ways. It could be challenging in a way where competitiveness for them, they see what it takes to get there.
Yeah.
But also, you got to let these guys be kids, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let them be kids, and also you got to let them grow. I kind of came into it when I came back, I don't want nothing to do with rugby.
Yeah.
I wanted nothing to do with rugby. I was just, I was done. I was done, official for 14 years. I was like, man, I just want to go back, and do this on the side. But again, it was we prayed about it with my wife, and I was just like, this is probably an avenue where I can connect with these younger generations now. And I've always said that rugby is secondary, man. We're all about the person first. We're about building that person, and what a way to do it through rugby, through what I've learned. So that was for me.
That's awesome. Also, after high school, correct me if I'm wrong, did you play secondary in the secondary school?
Yep.
How was that like? Because I think even secondary was popping up back then. Around your year. So
it was,
who was that, and who were one of the had, who was in your year? Who was in your secondary year?
My secondary year would be we had Sean Stowers, Victor Vito. Tanaro Latima, a lot of those boys. I can't remember. We had a few of those boys. I was kind of after secondary schools, that 19s, 21s, ABs started to come in. I was fortunate enough to make those teams as well. And it just grew from there.
That's awesome. And then you played majority of your MPC career with North Harbour.
Yep.
You spent a year and a bit in Taranaki. You played Super Rugby with the Blues. How's your experience in NZ Rugby itself, with MPC, your Super Rugby career? How was that experience for you?
Loved it. Loved it. I think it taught me everything about rugby. Yeah. Taught me all the fundamentals, I got to adapt to every type of rugby. We're known as a attack based kind of teammate. So we play what's in front of us. We play with flair. And that's probably why when people ask me like, oh, would you have gone earlier overseas?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I probably didn't get my foundation, New Zealand rugby gave me that foundation that I was able to, when I did move overseas, I was able to adapt to any other game that's been played. I credit New Zealand rugby, for everything pretty much. We are the pinnacle of rugby. We are the pinnacle of rugby. And when kids do ask me, oh, should I go overseas and thing, I was like, man, try and learn as much as you can here. Try and learn as much as you can here. And then when you go over, you'll be able to adapt, And I'm not going to say it's totally different, but it's more of, you're able to show that your foundation is stronger.
That's awesome, bro. You obviously, there are a few boys out there, and even girls, siblings, that their dream would be to play with their brothers or play with their siblings on a big stage, or even just in any team. What was it like for you? Like you mentioned, you played with Ken. What was it like for you just to have, just to know that you've got a sibling, you know, just 2 meters away from you or like right next to you playing with you. What was that like growing up, bro? And obviously within your professional career.
Oh, it's the best feeling, eh? Family, eh? Family of everything, eh?
Yeah.
So, yes, they say you've got your brothers on the team.
Yeah.
You know, but knowing that you've got a, you know, your blood brother that's right there.
Yeah.
You know, everything, anything pops up, you're there as well, eh?
Yeah. Yeah. You're there as well,
eh?
We on.
You know? And then also, you're the first one there. If he jumps the ball and you're like, silly. Come on, man. You better get
up. I know. There's two sides to it. Eh? You either you be positive and you be negative as well.
Yeah, you be negative. You're the first one to go. Suddenly, all right,
time. That's funny, bro. That's awesome. Like, bro, like even because even for me, like I got the chance to play my older brother in my last year. And it's the same thing, bro. Like, he was, every time, you know, if things was about to pop off, I looked to the side, he was there. And then if I was to drop the ball, same thing, chilly. Oh, here we go.
100%. What was it like representing your country, bro? You know, and took us through that. Obviously, your parents must have been proud. So what was that like for you and your family?
It was an honor, man. It was, when you say, you play for the jersey, you know, when they say, oh, yeah, you play for the jersey, you know, in the club. Nah, it's not until you go to Samoa, and you play in front of your people, and you hear the V, man, it's you can't express, you know, that feeling. That's one of those things. You just that proud moment, moment you get to represent your family. And, you know, Manu Samoa, we're not about money,
We're
not about money. You know, a lot of us, you know, actually pay to come back and play, you know, and that's what it means to us. And I do encourage, like, a lot of the younger generation, younger boys, you know, it's not until you get into that Manu Samoa environment, man, that you're going to be like, oh, I love this, man.
Yeah,
I don't want to go home. Just like brothers or cousins, you know, family, just 100%. A different environment. Yeah, but it's, man, it was a blessing. It was a blessing that I got to represent it and that high performance stage.
How was your debut, bro? Can you run us through your debut? Oh. How did that go leading up to it? Was it like nerves from Monday to Saturday, or where were you? When did you get the call up, bro?
So I debuted. Oh, funny story. So I made it back in 2010. All right, and that's when the Samoa Sevens won the Sevens competition. So we came back on the same flight. It was me, Paul Williams, and Anthony Piranese. All right, that's we debuted around that same time. So we caught the same flight as the Sevens team. So that's Sevens team. Everyone was waiting for their mate. So we get the same bus. We're on the same bus as them. We're in the back of the bus and everyone's giving them stuff. You know, there was for all of Samoa and we're at the back going, what are we doing here? You know these extras that are sitting at the back of this bus? You know, Pesamino is getting all the stuff and, you know, Wale Mai is getting all the stuff. And then these Paul Williams, John Pisi, and Anthony Ferranese at the back.
Just smile and wave, boys.
Yeah, just smile and wave. And they're like, going, oh, yeah, who's this? But my first game was against Tonga.
Oh, man.
We played Tonga and Samoa at a PNC. I think we ended up drawing that game. But, man, that game was like, village games, eh? You know, this is the ones you're like looking around like this, eh?
Making sure they get cheap shot at it.
Oh, you get a throw that pass, eh? You're like, 1, 2, 3.
Oh, that's awesome, bro. That's awesome, mate. You spent your, majority of your career over in Europe, you know, with Clermont and Northampton. What was the experience like? Like, I know that you mentioned earlier that it would have been good if you were to learn your foundation before you went over or whatnot. But what was that like for you, your experience going over the different culture, obviously? But, like, what was that like for you as a young Polynesian kid?
Scary, eh? Scary. Yeah. I think going in, I went to Clermont as a medical joker for about 8 months. Or right. Even that, going to a new place, don't speak English, you know. Mm. And I was engaged then to my wife then. So then, you know, she came over for the last couple of months. But even just being there by myself, yeah. I was like, whoa. But I had boys like Sione Lawaki there, Wax, you know, Mr. Mm. Saul, you know, Tasisa Lavia, all those boys, T Bolo. So I had a lot of Kim Se Neil. Mm. Yeah, I had a lot of boys there to help me out. Hey, it wasn't until I went to England. Me and my wife just got married. And 2 days later, we left straight after the World Cup here in New Zealand.
Yeah.
And then just in a new place, but I kind of realized, you know, the reality that of what my parents went through. Hey, what my parents went through when they came over to a new country. But different scenarios where we got a house, you know, we got money to do what we can, eh? And I think about my parents when they came over to New Zealand, that same kind of thing, but didn't have this connections that we have, eh? And to start from scratch, you know, and how daunting that would have been for them.
Yeah.
So I was, it was hard. It was hard for me.
Yeah.
I think I was lucky I had my wife there. I had my wife there to, you know, to help me out, and even the play of rugby over there, it's boring. You know, it's boring. Like, oh, seriously, you know, you come from running rugby to scrums, you know, scrums to get penalty, and I was like, what are you doing? You
know? Yeah, 100,
like,
100.
Lineup drives, eh? You're like driving it for like 20, 30 minutes, and you're getting... You're getting cold in this winter, and you're like, I say. Like, all that kind of stuff. Huh? Even when the snow comes, hey, it's funny when the snow comes, you know, the islanders here, and they're like, wow, this is amazing. First day, hey, you're in spring, and you get cold feet, everything. Second day, hey, oh, double tights, double underwear, double everything. Hey.
That's awesome. Like, it's, you know, just hearing about the different atmospheres, eh? Like between NZ rugby and Europe. Man, that's
They awesome. Love rugby there, man. In Northampton, they're a rugby town.
Yeah.
So I think that was another thing that I did enjoy was their supporters. Hey, very different to here. Very different to here. And, you know, I think because of the stadiums are really big here, you know, there's not many people that come to all the games.
So
over there, it's Northampton's always sold up, sold up. You know, and you see them on the side of the road and everything. Yeah, they love you and everything. And you're like, oh, yeah. Can I just eat my my KFC, please?
Obviously you mentioned, you know, Wax, RIP Wax, obviously, and the boys that are there helping you out. I find that nowadays there are a lot of island boys overseas, whether they're in France, whether they're in Europe, whether they're in Japan, there's a lot. What was it for you guys that were over there, and probably just a handful of you guys? Like, did you guys have to tee up, you know, every day to like get around places, or go for feeds together to understand the culture, or even like during trainings, like, did you guys have to, you know, speak English? Everyone had to speak English just for you guys, or whatever. Like, how was that for you guys, being over there and the dynamic of the country?
Yeah, you know, like all Pacifica, you know, we just draw to each other. It doesn't matter, you know. It's like we've known each other for years, You know, when we see each other, so it's more of, we stuck together. Okay, so the foreigners a lot stuck together, you know, and then experience a lot of those the culture together.
We're just talking, like, you're the first guest that played overseas that said, man, European rugby's boring.
So then, everything is pouring. It's just, but the money's not pouring.
The money's not pouring, eh?
But like some of the times that you think, you look down the weather and there was like -5°. You're like, oh, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, no. And then the check comes in the mail and it's like, you're like, this is why I come out and miss the
pizza. It's the next game in the snow. Sweet.
Got it.
That's cool. Getting back to the, you know, the Manu Samoa, I want to rewind it back in 2011. A historic win for the Manu against Australia, against the Wallabies. And I was looking up, because I was looking up the squad eight at that time last night. And I was, you know, you had the likes of Khan, Fotoli'i, and Tusi was on first five. And then you and Seilala Mapusua were partnered up in the middle. Yep. And then Sayless.
Yeah, Sayless.
Yeah, he was on the wing.
Alessandro on the other wing.
Yeah, Alessandro on the other wing. And then Paul Williams at fullback.
What a
man,
squad.
That game, I know for you guys, when you go to every game, it's win. You know, you're not going in there to be like, oh, I'm not sure if we're going to win. But talk to us on that day, you know, with the mentality, with the team, and what was your guys' game plan? And the feeling after, you know, when you guys secured that win, the first win against a tier one nation in rugby.
So leading up to it, we had just been at PNC and Samoa. So we had half our squad came to Australia, and the other half still had to play Fiji in the last game. So we had some good some good trainings before everyone came in. But the thing is that everyone doesn't know is that we had an Aussie TA with us, say technical advisor. Wow. His name was Scott Wisemantle. And man, his game plan that he put for us, it worked. And guess what that game plan was?
What was it?
Bomber and smash them. That was the game plan. Sorry. If you watch the game, how many times did we bomber and just faster than me? But like, yeah, that was more like it was the physicality that we're after.
Yeah.
They talk about it, but it was how can we keep it for 80 minutes?
Mm.
You know, and then I think during the game, we started to score some tries and the belief was there. But it was always there from the start. But I think it just picked up the physical side of it. Because we tend to get tired and then it goes down and, you know, and then. But I think because we knew, you know, man, we've got a good chance here.
Yeah.
You know, well, we can do this. That belief was there and, you know, brings out that second wind.
Yeah.
100%. And your head just goes cut in, you just start doing things.
that was
one of the best games I've ever been a part of. Just to see our crowd that's in Australia.
Yeah.
And just see some more people at the end of it as well. I think also leading to the game, we had watched the last time we played Australia. When we got sassed, and the only thing that people remember is Trevor Leotza trying to hit Wendell Sailor. That's the only one that they remember from their game. But that was kind of another motivation for us. One, don't get sassed.
Yeah.
And then two was, you know, we could do this.
Yeah.
You know, leading up to the World Cup as well.
Yeah. Was it intentional for you guys to smash Thigby Yohane? Because the poor guy, every time he touches the ball, solely.
Nah, it was more my mate, Rod Davis.
Oh, man.
So that was his first and last time for the Wallabies.
Man.
What's funny is that I got to play with Rod Davis at the Force, at Western Force when I went there.
Yeah.
And it was, and one of the trainings, they're like, you know, the boys are mocking him about his one Wallaby debut and everything.
Because he was mean at the Reds in that year, eh?
Yeah.
Like he was
fast.
Yeah.
He was
mean. Fast, but different when the bulldozer of Alessandro's after him.
Yeah.
I asked him, I go, Sully, how'd you feel after the game? He goes, So like, I felt like I wanted to retire. But he goes, that's why I left to go to Japan. Because of that.
Man, that's I gotta say, bro, like, you know, the whole of Samoa, proud of you guys, and it's still a good game to go back and watch, and just seeing how proud you guys were, and you guys had a whole country behind you, even, you know, the whole of South Auckland, and, you know, the whole of Okilangi behind you guys, and
the whole of Tonga too.
Yeah, the whole of Tonga too. You know,
hey, pretty much the Pacific. They should say that some people didn't make the plane the next day, eh?
And we'll leave it at that, eh?
That was probably gonna happen. If you know, you know, eh?
Yes. We'll leave it at that. You know who you are.
So like, that's when you know it was a good one. Shadows. You know, in the game of rugby, a lot of people, a lot of fans, and you know, that watch, they don't know the behind the scenes for rugby players. All they see is them, you know, on the media, when they're on the field, you know, and because it's different when you rugby players and athletes, professional players, go back to the families, and that's what they don't see. And a lot of that has to do with that mental health, you know, and mental health. It's awesome hearing players now speaking more about mental health, because it helps the younger ones help get through it. Was there any a time in your career where you felt your lowest, and to a point where you were going to be like, nah, I think that's enough rugby for me, because, you know, all of this is happening? Was there ever a time that you felt like that?
Yeah. Towards the end of my Northampton career, my time in Northampton, I just captained the squad for the first time. So it was amazing for me. I was like, wow. You know, we played Leinster. And before that, I had really, you know, they had offered me another contract to stay, but I said to my wife, you know, I need something new. You know, I felt I was a bit stale or a bit complacent up at Northampton. Eh? So I needed something new. Played Leinster, went for a Valia tackle, and then, you know, did my shoulder in the first 3 minutes of the game. But I don't want to come off.
Yeah.
Came off at half time, and then I had done the nerve on my shoulder.
Dang.
And then through that injury period, I was out for about 9 months or 6 months, I reckon. Try to come back. But I was also up for contract. So again, it's you know, I was going into places like Wasps. You know, and then, you know, they see my shoulder and everything. Oh, yes, we want to sign you, da, da, da. Go do the medical. No, you know, don't pass it, you know, and that kind of stuff. And then me and my wife came back to New Zealand, and then I was in kind of in limbo. I wanted to play, but also probably my body was telling me no. But again, that was more my... It's what I've been doing for 14 years. It's what I've been doing. So I was just like, I don't want to give it up. And then it wasn't until I even flew to France, to Paris, for 3 days just to do a medical, you know. And then I signed. They were about to sign, and then they changed. They changed owners on the day, so he didn't want anything to do with new players coming in. So it was just like, man, God was telling me this is probably not for you. And then 5 months down the track, I went to Western Force. Even there, I probably only played like 2 or 3 games, and my body was just getting little injuries, getting, you know, hamstrings here, you know, my first game playing against Rebels, Melbourne Rebels, went in for a big tackle and popped my shoulder. Do you know what I mean? And those were all signs, and it was just hard. Eh? It was hard because I was thinking, this is it. And then I came to terms with it with my wife, and I was just like, you know, my kids are getting a bit older now. You know, it's time to move on in the next phase. So then that's the time when I really went down, man. I really went down, and it's that transition. It's transition from something that's so routine to going to something very different, very different. You know, and that's the time when I needed to speak up, you know, and I wasn't, and I was doing, you know, it was more of turning to the drink, turning to, you know, just bad things, you know, just moody here, you know, and I just didn't have anyone to speak to, just my wife, you know, my family, or not even being able to speak to my parents, just because of, you know, that whaalo and that, you know, that respect I had for them, I couldn't even speak up. Yeah, hey. So that was the hardest time for me. It's just that transition.
That's awesome. You touched on the medical side of things. It's the first time that someone has mentioned or has shown us the insight into a contract signing. And it seems like you've explained in a way where medical assessments are part of contract signings. Is that correct, mate?
Yep.
Is that how it works?
Yep. Well, you gotta remember where investments are.
Yeah.
Where investments, where's our investments? It's all about business, huh? So if you're signing a 2-year business, is this guy gonna give me the certain amount of games? Or is this person gonna last? So that's where clubs look at, so when they do their medical reviews, they'll see their medical from the past club, and you know, like, or you've had 2 operations on your shoulders, you've had 2 knee surgeries.
Yeah.
Is it someone that I'm gonna sign? Is it someone that that's gonna get his money, their money's worth?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's awesome, mate. Like, yeah, I know for myself, Sifa, and probably others do understand that, but probably for our viewers that how you're like, it'll be a shock to them to be like, oh shucks, they you know, a medical assessment, like, you know, but that's because that's the first insight that probably someone that didn't know about it have heard about stuff like that. So that's awesome, bro. And thanks for being vulnerable in that kind of space for you, bro. So thanks.
Yeah. You know, it's always good, because now that you're teaching, now that you're in the industry, you know, it's good because you're there, you can give insights to up and coming players. But how did teaching come around, bro?
So I happened to go speak at school as a guest speaker to our Pasifika kids. To our Pasifika kids. And it was a bit of a lineup. It was me, Eugene Berriman, Adesanya's coach, Israel Adesanya. Israel Adesanya was there to speak as well. And then from then, it was just more talking about my story, being an old Massey boy, being in the professional business, now, you know, leaving. It was just about, you know, giving some advice to our younger generation, and then from there, the principal, Glenn Denham, he was just like, oh, we got this role for you, that could fit in with, you know, being an ex-Massey boy, you know, the non-teaching role, teaching dean, you know, just to share your life stories and be there for the younger kids. And I was like, oh, I was quite scared, because it's but different to what I'm used to. Different to what I'm used to. But it was, you know, I prayed about it, and then I was just saying to my wife, you know, this is my passion. It's more for youth, passion of our youth. And I've always been also, you know, in my rugby career, I've always taken, you know, the younger kids under my wing in terms of, you know, teaching them their skills. It doesn't matter if you're in the same position. You know, you're blessed with what people taught me, you know, and I'll bless you in the same way, you know, because I have some good role models, like, you know, Kieran Mealamu, you know, Doug Haller, Joe Rokoko. All those boys took me under their wing when I was a young kid coming through, 18-year-old, at the Blues. So, you know, those experiences I learned, you know, just taken me through, and I hope that they can do the same with the younger kids coming through.
Man, that's amazing, bro. And like, thank you so much for doing that, because it's, you know, people like you and, you know, the likes of Dwayne Toko as well. Shout out to the
that
keep giving back to communities, because that's what the youth need nowadays. It's more connection between the generation that have gone with them now. So hey, shout outs. Good job, Moso.
Thanks, bro.
Yeah. Nice, Dougs. Just a few more questions, bro, before we get into our quick fire. What's next for George Pisi?
What's next?
Heaps.
Well, at the moment, you know, we're trying to build up the rugby academy up in Massey High School in terms of as a Pisi rugby academy. Right. That's what we're trying to build into there. Hey, and you know, our values of better people make better rugby players. You know, same values that the All Blacks are doing, eh? Yeah. And so that kind of stuff we're trying to start up. Also, you know, I think my kids are studying, you know, they're at Rosebank Primary. My wife's a teacher at Rosebank Primary, bilingual unit. Yeah.
Yep.
Nice. That's cool.
You know, and, you know, just keeping that tengangana, eh? And that's another thing for me, just building my ngangana and growing from there.
That's awesome, bro. That's awesome. And shout out to Rosebank Primary, bilingual unit.
Let's go.
Bilingual classes is the way, guys.
Yeah, that's the way.
That's the way. Bilingual unit, mate. Sign your kids up in bilingual units. Last question before we get into our quick fire. Advice for 16-year-old George Pisi. What would you tell 16-year-old George Pisi?
Stay in school, man. Just your teacher, man. Stop being a fifth grade kid, man. Just go for your lunch. That's what I will tell him.
Yeah.
That's the advice I would tell him. I say, man, you gotta stay in school. You know, listen, because listen. You know, you're doing the hard yards later on. Eh? That's your passport. That's your passport.
Yeah. Man. Shao Mausa. Now we're going to move on to our quick fire. We got 5 quick fire questions for you. And the last question we've asked all our guests. So it's been the same 5th question through everyone. So we're looking forward to your answer for that one. But here we go. Quick fire, George PC. Your first quick fire question is, do you have a go-to pre-game track, and what is that?
Ooh, pre-game track. Sorry, you probably laugh, but it's Wham from George Michael's in there. Sorry, why are you laughing?
Nah, I'm not. I was wondering.
Nah, I was gonna say shout to the Lord, Hussong, but.
Nah, I was wondering, because for our younger generation, if you could give us like, you know, like a little cover of Wham, bro.
Oh, wait, sorry. Sorry, wahalo, man.
Nah, I was
sorry, my wife's the singer, I'm the rapper.
Oh, yo.
They're rapping in Wham.
Nah, don't worry, I'll edit it in a way where I'll put the soundtrack behind. Nah, yo, so your next question, number 2. Here's I'm looking forward to your answer. Out of Ken and Tusi, okay, your 2 brothers, one of them. So who would help you survive on an island out of Ken and Tusi? If you'd have to pick between, and why?
Ken.
Why? Why not Tusi?
Tusi will probably moan that he's already stuck on the island with me. And Ken's more looking like a bushman than anyone, so
at least you can boss around Ken, eh?
That's why he's basically that was right.
Yeah, I'll be the one getting the firewood. Ken.
There we go. Sorry, Tusi. Ken's the winner on this one. Your 3rd one, who's the toughest player you faced in your career?
Ooh, toughest player. I'll say Manu Tuilangi.
Oh, yeah.
I think at his prime, he was just a beast to play against. Because we had that rivalry for Leicester and Northampton. Eh? Yeah. I was like, Sam, man, this guy's just running. I have to tackle him all day.
Man, yo, shout out to those. So, just a side note, one of my favorite tackles that you did was on Owen Farrell. That was so satisfying. That was satisfying to see. That's another subject. Your next one, your 4th one. If you would spend a day in someone else's shoes, who would that be?
Anybody. Yeah.
Anybody's shoes. probably Michael Jordan's shoes, eh? Just to see how he lives that life.
Surely. I've heard it all.
Michael Jordan's shoes.
That's a good one.
Yo, you just want to fly, eh?
I say Michael Jordan, prime Michael Jordan.
Oh, yo.
Not Michael Jordan now. They think he's a golf player.
Yo, prime. Here's your last question. This is the last question that we've asked everyone else as well. Your top five dinner guests. You have dinner tomorrow night, and you get to invite your top five dinner guests. Could be a celebrity, someone that has passed on, or some, you know, people are still living. Anyone. Who is your top five?
I would say Nelson Mandela.
You.
Denzel Washington.
Good start. Good start.
I have my wife there.
Hey, yeah, that's good. Hey,
that should have been your first pick first.
I'm going to say, I'll be like, I'll probably first up.
Should have been your first pick.
Please.
Elton George.
Team Wars.
Michael Jordan.
Yo.
Yeah.
Michael Jordan. And who's the last person I have? Yeah. Probably Tiger Woods.
Yo, and what's
what I hear? The only reason, because I know that we can mock Tiger Woods all day.
Surely, not that. Look. Also, you know the only reason why you're here,
because then if they start mocking me, then I get straight to Tiger Woods. It's like, hey, what number was the one that you were doing, eh?
Surely. What's on the dinner table there? What's being served? What's on the menu?
The chef is cooking.
You'll have to go with a umu man with a boy, everything. Yo,
I don't know if it's us cooking. I don't know if you get that. I don't know if you get that, bro. But yo, we'll try.
We'll try.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, the man himself. Thank you so much, Uso, for chilling with us tonight. Thank you for giving up your time with your Inga. We pray for an awesome year. I know Massey Rugby is excited. You know, we're excited to hear more about not only Massey Rugby, but what you guys are doing at school. Thank you so much for always giving back to our community. Ladies and gentlemen, George Pisi is your Uso. Sefa is your Toko Atu. Sayless Podcast. We out. Let's go.